Yeah, anyway, yeah, thanks for having me. Okay, yeah, good, recording's going. Yeah, thanks for inviting me to give this lecture here. It's been something I've been looking forward to, and I think it was good that we moved it after the Eisenbahn to get a bit more peace and calm into everyone's mind to have this now. Anyway, thanks very much for that, and I'm glad to be here. So indeed, I'm going to talk about some of the stuff that you mentioned and some of the stuff that's mine and some of the stuff is not. But overall, it'll be themed around fMRI acquisition at ultra high field, and also moving away from standard gradient echo, echo planar bolt acquisition, as it were. So in the background here, you see what you perfectly pronounced as Maastricht University. So this is our the building of our department here on the right hand side, and on the left hand side, you see where the scanners are, which in our case is a human 3T, 70, and 9.4 Tesla scanner. So 9.4 T is it's a whole body magnet actually, but with only head gradients in it. There will be a couple of things shown from the 9.4, but mostly 7 Tesla stuff. And I'm not going to show any 3 Tesla really, apart from a little bit from my far past. Okay, so the original motivation to get those scanners into place was a local interest in doing high resolution fMRI. And that was mainly Rainer Goebel at the time. So he then ventured out and tried to figure out a way of getting those scanners to come to Maastricht. And ultimately this company Scan Nexus came to be with now the 3 scanners. But the initial starting point was really to do some high resolution fMRI and figure out some way of actually sampling across the cortex in some way that we can actually make sense of what's happening inside it, rather than just doing blobology that we were all used to from 1.5 and 3 Tesla in the preceding decade. But the question, of course, is and still remains, it will always remain, what is small, and is small really small enough? And I think the continued push towards higher field strength indicates that nobody's ever happy with what they can do, and they'll always do a little bit better in terms of spatial resolution and understanding what is really happening at the cortical and also columnar level in the brain. So as a brief outline here, I'll just start off with some very general musings, general considerations on ultra high field and how lucky we are to be doing functional imaging. I mentioned a little bit about 2D, 3D echoplanar sequences, and then go into the more interesting contrast preparations that we spend a lot of time with these days as vaso. It's just, this should be CBF, blood flow, also ABC, so arterial blood contrast. That's the more recent thing. I'll talk about that a little bit. And then a good chunk of the remaining part will be dedicated to going spiral, sort of non-Cartesian stuff that I've been venturing into in my group recently, and in particular the application to CBB and CBF imaging. I think not a secret here to this audience is, I mean, if you have more field, you have more SNR, and there's the very classic results here coming from the Tübingen group from Rolf Pohlmann's paper in 2015, where they looked at the ratio between SNR gains going from 3 to 7 Tesla, but also going from 7 Tesla to 9.4 Tesla, using an as fair as possible comparison. And what they found is, luckily, that there was not just a linear increase in B0, in SNR with B0, as you would maybe very naively think, but it's actually something that's closer to what is predicted by ultimate intrinsic SNR theory, which is something with this exponent here, which very clearly is good news. So you're getting more than your Tesla's worth of SNR if you buy such a big machine. More recently, in the context of a consortium project that's headed by Nicolas Boulon, the Aroma, part of which is also the 11.7 Tesla scanner, which has now been commissioned at Neurospin. We did some SNR measurements actually on Phantom, that is, at 3 Tesla, 7 Tesla, 9.4 T, 10.5 T, and 11.7, using the midpoint here, just looking at the center of the Phantom here in sort of nominal CP mode. And comparing the SNR values there, we actually ended up observing a SNR dependence on field strength that is even stronger than what was observed by Pohlmann. So instead of the 165, we're now having a 1.92, which is yet a little closer to what's predicted by the theory and is actually indicative of even further gains that we can get at high field as we move on, towards 10.5, 11, 7, 14 Teslas on the horizon, and at least 2 places in Europe. And I'm sure there will be some human imaging on those field strengths soon as well. But of course, it's not only about SNR. A lot of things happen as you move up in field strength. There's susceptibility and phase contrast, which for most things is good. there's changes in all sorts of contrasts driven by the shortening of T2 and T2 star, but the lengthening of T1. Things are mixing differently. You have chemical shift and spectral resolution increasing a big deal with field strengths. Other things like magnetization transfer, which of course is also well established at 3 tesla, but also gets a bit more interesting at 7 tesla. And not all these things are good, but also not all of them are bad. I think on the whole, we can conclude that taken together with the SNR gains we get at high field, they are good. So lots of green smileys here and very few little red ones here. This is supposed to represent the shortening of the T2 star, which makes some of the functional acquisition actually a bit tricky because you don't have the time to sample with the larger matrix size what you actually want to acquire at a high resolution. So things do get a bit tricky, but sensitivity goes up a big deal. Yeah, that is in fact shown here on this slide taken from the EPIC Uludag paper from 2009. Some simulations here on what the signal behavior of the gradient echo T2 star and the spin echo T2 weighted signals would be in terms of expected signals or signal changes in the micro and macrovasculature. And as we all know, the T2 star weighted signal just shoots up drastically with field strength. This is really good news in terms of sensitivity. We get a lot. The signal may not be coming from the place that we're most interested in, maybe not where the neuron activation is, but certainly if you just want to measure a Bold effect, then you're very well off doing gradient echo at high field. Spin echo is nice in the sense that the weighting towards the microvasculature increases relatively more strongly than that to the macrovasculature, which in fact is even suppressed a little bit. So the specificity of Bold at high field strength measured with T2 contrast actually goes up. So there's a lot of good things to be taken advantage of as we go up in field strength on top of purely just the signal gains. Nevertheless, and this is a couple of slides that I just show to remind people how we do things and what our expectations are. If we consider this SNR gain with field strength that Poman measured, I'll just leave it up here in the corner, and we consider the typical voxel sizes that people are interested in, say at 3 tesla, that might be 2.5 millimeter isotropic, at 7 tesla, 0.8, at 9.4, might be 0.7. But if you look at the relative voxel volumes that you are looking at in going from 2.5 to 0.8 isotropic, that's a 31 times reduction in volume, which is rather unmatched by the approximately factor 2 gain in pure sensitivity or SNR when doing that step in field strength. And this just continues all the way if you go up to the higher field strengths and possibly ambitious resolutions here, that you have a voxel volume reduction, which is completely unbalanced by the SNR increase you have. So overall, at first sight, it looks like that we're being unreasonably greedy in our expectations of what we want high field to deliver to us, suddenly giving us a contrast, Bold sensitivities or other fMRI sensitivities that are not actually compatible with that drastic volume reduction that we're doing in comparison to say 3 tesla scanning. Nevertheless, of course, I mean, this is just for illustration and bear this in mind. I mean, we are being greedy. We very clearly are, but if we weren't, I think we wouldn't have that drive to develop new techniques and make hardware better and develop new sequences, new contrasts, et cetera, right? We do want to get as much out of our scanners, no matter what field strengths we are at, and we're pushing the limits where we can. So that being said here, we are being greedy here, but it's obviously not impossible, right? I mean, just that last ISRM here, Renzo showed some vaso at actually 0.4 millimeter isotropic at 7 tesla, according to this table, that shouldn't even be allowed. But of course it works, and it shows a beautiful activation here. Similarly here, the first data coming out of Minnesota from the 10.5 tesla scanner, actually in this talk, Carmit even showed some 350 micron isotropic, even I believe at this point resolution from the 10.5, some Bold activation together with some Nordic data cleaning. So it is clearly possible, despite the sort of grim looking table that I'm not covering up with those first nice looking results from the, that great 7 tesla scanner in Berkeley, but also the new 10.5 in Minnesota. So things are possible, even at those very high spatial resolutions, even you think that from an SNR perspective, that should be rather difficult. Nevertheless, it is an uphill battle for sensitivity. We will always be in a regime where the ratio between the physiological noise or the temporal noise and the pure image noise is determined by thermal SNR. We will always want to increase our voxel resolution to a point where the voxels become so tiny, the voxel volume so small, that we will be limited by the pure SNR and less of the physiological effects. That actually also the regime where we want to be, where parallel imaging and all the other aspects of fast acquisition actually hurt us the least. And this figure here is taken from the, you know, the classic Trentafillou paper that actually made that illustration quite nicely for the, you know, resolutions here of 1.5, 3, and 7 tesla, where you can see the different voxel volumes and how fast you end up on the slope here. Very, very late you arrive here for 7 tesla, but quite early on you do for the lower field strengths. Anyhow, so this is the regime in which we will be operating no matter what we do. I think we all strive towards high resolutions at high field strengths in our community here. Well, this is a picture of our playing field. This is the triangle we're trapped in, one way or another. And no matter what field strength and no matter how much SNR we actually have, no matter what methods we choose, there is always some compromise to be made between our spatial resolution, our temporal resolution, and our coverage. There is just no escaping it. And sometimes we get lucky and some magic happens and this playing field gets a bit better because we add a little bit of B0 or because we get a new coil, or we invent a new contrast that is somehow fantastic. And there is a bit more flexibility and a bit more gains that we can trade off. But the rule of the game remains that we can't have it all at the same time. I think that is what we have to bear in mind. And I think that also matches everyone's experience, right? There's always some trade-off that we need to make in MRI and certainly in fMRI as well. When it comes to the sources of signal and SNR, well, we have to take home every little bit that we can get. I mean, the harder we push towards the limit of what's possible, the more we need to actually get everything in the chain to work well. Some might spend a few million extra and buy a bigger magnet, but then you have to deal with the inhomogeneity. Some might spend hundreds, three hundreds of thousands for new gradient performance and not invest so much in the B0. I'm thinking of the next gen 7 tesla in Berkeley, for example, versus, you know, the high field scanners that are being put up elsewhere. There is RF transmit that's got to work out. You need good coils, good coil efficiency. The V1 management has to work well, homogeneity in V1 and SAR needs to be sorted out. Then the receive coils have to be well, pulse sequences have to work well, image reconstruction has to work well. And then you need to do some things with the data that also makes sense, right? You have to have good fMRI designs to start with and need to know how to analyze your data, but then are also more and more importance of actually denoising the data using, you know, Stark that Renzer proposed a while ago, or the Nordic denoising, which is recently popular and seems to add a lot of, you know, potential of what we can squeeze out of really, really high resolution data. Yeah, so here just indicated a bunch of places that I've worked on. You know, mainly pulse sequences, some image reconstruction, and some parallel transmit as well. Okay, so for our mission to do high resolution fMRI, then there is some relief. So there is SNR gains, there is possibilities to reduce the voxels, and for covering the cortex, which typically has a width of 2 to 4 millimeters, it is already quite fantastic if we can do. Sorry, the dog is going crazy here. That's a huge wasp. Let me just sort that out. Sorry. All right, 2 lives saved. Okay, wasp outside and dog alive. Okay, so I think typically when we talk about cortical resolutions here, it's already very nice if we get the top layers, the bottom layers, and the middle layers somehow. So we have a coverage of about 3 voxels, maybe 4 voxels across the cortical depths. It's already quite great. So we're talking about, you know, 0.8 millimeter or 1 millimeter voxels as the minimum that we need to have in order to get that sorted out. But again, the question is small really small enough? And the answer, of course, is no. I mean, we want to resolve in finer detail what we can get out from that depth information that is there without being overly biased by, say, the draining vein effects or some other bias that makes the interpretation of the then high or nominally high resolution data difficult. What's also good news, people have been extremely creative in the last decade or so. And there is a rapidly growing world now that goes beyond just doing bold EPI. And when I say bold EPI, I mean gradient and echo and span echo alike. There is all these different things that have crept up. I mean, here's sort of different sequences, basically. So 3D EPI, 2D, the multiband, then there's line scanning, there's grace, there's inner volume selective things, there's flash, spiral sequence. You can throw some wave copy into it. There's SSFP acquisitions. And on the contrast side, well, I mean, the classics here, of course, are spin echo, the CBF, the CBV, all that I don't even mention, but then there's the ABC contrast, that relatively new thing that's come up in the last few years. There's T2 preparations that have been used successfully in some tricky brain areas. And you can make your choice depending on what you want to do and what your question is. But again, you are confined to that triangle for one thing. But you now have the choice of method, and that will allow you a further trade-off in specificity and sensitivity. Right? If you want to go gradient echo bold, you can be like super sensitive, but your specificity goes out the window. And if you want to do vaso, your specificity might go up, but you're compromising a lot in terms of sensitivity. So your experimental durations become longer, et cetera, et cetera. And this slide I've stolen here from Renzo that he showed at the Highfield workshop. And he summarized it very nicely in terms of this game, which we all know probably. So you have, in this case, maybe different vehicles, and depending on where you are and where you want to go, an airplane might be the best choice. It's fast to get you across the Atlantic. It's cost you a lot of money. It's not very comfortable and it's big. But if you're at a lake, for instance, you might go on a sailing boat, which is going to be very slow, but the comfort is a bit bigger, but it's low cost, it's environmentally friendly. And with a car, you can do a perfect commute. And similarly, depending on what your research question or what your task at hand is, you can choose between those methods of doing your bold imaging or your functional imaging. It could be great in echo bold if you want maximally sensitivity, but then specificity is going to be low. It's hugely accessible, for example, no training needed. It's very, you find it in every scanner and you get a lot of volume coverage out of it. Very easy. But if you need to have a very high specificity, for instance, the vaso to take the other end of the spectrum here, you're compromising in sensitivity. Also, accessibility is lower. People will generally need help to use it. And your volume coverage, for most settings at least, is going to be used lower, right? And also the skill level is going to be high versus, for instance, the low skill level needed for gradient echo bold. I mean, it's a sort of a playful one of it, basically showing what the situation is. You have to choose your battles and you have to choose your weapons according to what you want to do. Okay. So, yeah, moving on. So I'll just talk a little bit about sequences for functional imaging now, starting off with some talks about EPI, but then I move on into the other sequences and other preparations we can do, including the CBV and the ASL and other preparations. So EPI, I mentioned EPI a heck of a lot, and I will continue to mention it despite what's in the title. EPI is just the undisputed workhorse of fMRI. It is fast and it is also highly matured. I mean, after all, it was invented, can't even calculate how many years ago that is. It's certainly a year older than me. Mansfield came up with it in 1977, that's a long time ago. And it is nice also because it is straightforward lead to reconstruct. It's just a 2D or 3D Fourier transform, and also everything is linear in terms of parallel imaging. There's no gridding needed. It's computationally cheap, and it's been used extremely successfully for bold, for ASL, for basal, for diffusion weighting. It's been used in the brain. It's even in the body. It actually finds a lot of application for, you know, whatever imaging and so forth. And the most common implementation is some form of single shot 2D. That could be just with single slice or multiband these days, and it just worked extremely well, and it's proven itself extremely well in the field for many, many years now. In some cases, 3D EPI becomes attractive. Then you do a slab excitation and you have an additional phase encoding direction in the Z direction, especially at ultra high field and when you go towards higher resolution. There are some SNR benefits of 3D sampling over 2D sampling. The slice profiles are better defined, spin history is a bit better in terms of motion sensitivity. And you can undersampling in that additional phase encoding direction as much as you can undersample in the multiband acquisition, for example. And So this is one image that comes from one of Renzo's paper here, where he looked at the relative temporal signal to noise of 3D EPI versus 2D EPI as a function of voxel sizes. And it turns out, as has also been observed by a whole bunch of other people in the past 10 years or so, that at those moderate or low resolutions, and we're talking about 7 Tesla here, then 2D is superior. And at some point, you reach a crossing, which tends to be around 1.2, 1.5 millimeter isotropic, where then the 3D takes over. So that is a red line here. And it's more sensitive, actually considerably more sensitive, relatively speaking, than the 2D. So for these higher spatial resolutions there. So those are choices you can make again, and those are widely available sequences. What has definitely been a real game changer for both the 2D and the 3D is the introduction of controlled aliasing, which is basically the blipping between k-space lines along the z direction, which allows you to make much better use of the available coil sensitivities. And those benefits are actually the same for the 2D and 3D cases. It doesn't really matter. The k-space representation is the same. And I think we should also be grateful to, well, Felix Breuer and these people from Würzburg who described it first for the normal sort of structural sequences. But then for the echo planar, I think a lot of credit here in the field needs to go to Cowen for coming up with this technique. Groundwork, important stuff, by the way. Nita Nunes, let's not forget her in Lisbon. She actually, she suggested that first, how to do the blipping in EPI, and with a bit of extra tweaking, and that actually came to happen properly with the work of Cowen in 2012. Good, just for an example here on what flexibility it actually adds in trading off coil encoding between the different imaging directions. And that is really what this Kuiper-Rinja stuff allows you to do. You can take all the coil encoding information from two dimensions and lump together and push it along one or the other, or share it at will between them. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to reach acceleration factors as something like 16, for example, right? Like a 4x4 acceleration is sort of imaginable with a good coil array, but you can actually pull the 4x4 and push them one direction to do like crazy in-plane undersampling, as in this case here for something high resolution, or factor 16 in this case, through-plane undersampling here for like something really fast. So just to illustrate the sort of the power of what this Kuiper-Rinja stuff actually has. And it is really, really nice how much flexibility this has given us, especially for the multiband imaging that is now very commonly used as well. But I mean, for the 3D stuff, just the same. Yeah, just to tickle out a little bit extra from the EPI, you can add wave encoding. That's been driven by again, the MGH group, so Burke and Bilgic and Cowen in particular. So to get access to even the third coil encoding dimension in the sequence, you can wiggle around a gradient doing a readout and spread the aliasing in such a way that it's really making full use of the 3D foil coil encoding and not just the 2D. And that is actually very nice. Recently, there's been a push to put this into EPI as well. There's been a couple of papers coming out from that group, which is nice. It's technically more challenging because the EPI readout is just a lot shorter, and there's only so much wiggling that you can do during the 1 millisecond readout. And if you look at the first data that we tried to acquire actually a few years ago, we don't really see much benefit yet by having Kuiper-Rinja gradients put onto what is already a highly accelerated acquisition. But there are some benefits here if you look at the those values here. If you compare the average G factor penalties of 1.69 here in this case, they get reduced a little bit. And the same for the maximum G factor penalty that actually gets reduced quite a bit. Nevertheless, there's a lot more work to be done. We should keep our eyes open and see what comes out of the MGH group, because they've actually started using it for diffusion and build type acquisitions. And it's quite exciting to see that work as well. And I think with that, EPI will come to its end and will have reached its maturity to the point that we can push. But who knows what more there will be in the future. Yeah, okay. So that's on bold type of things. Let's look at vascular space occupancy for a little bit. It's actually very nice to give this talk here. Well, not physically, unfortunately, with you guys, Jun, but it would have been nice to actually come over and do it there for real and meet those people that had actually worked on this stuff in the early days. And I hope I will get the chance to do that at some point. But Yeah, the vasal, the vascular space occupancy is, well, as you know, an fMRI based on measuring blood volume changes. And Han Zhang Lu, I think, was the driving force there, together with Peter van Zaar, no doubt. And I think they probably came up with it together in early 2000s. And it is actually a really simple idea, right? It's you have an inversion pulse, and then you wait some time, and then you acquire one slice. And what you do is you time your acquisition in such a way that you take advantage of a subtle difference in T1 between the gray matter and the blood in the cortex, and you acquire the image at the point where the blood goes through the null point, so that black stuff here, as it were. And then you acquire, and when your activation goes up, your signal goes down, and then you get an activation plot pretty much as you are used to. You just have to invert the curve, which has been done for us in this case. And you can measure your activation by actually measuring the small blood volume change that's happening in your cortex, but actually closer to the site of neuronal activation, and that's the beauty of it, than what you would observe in a gradient echo-bolt experiment or even CBF. So I'm not gonna go into the different dynamics of this curve, but it's triggered and sparked a lot of interest, because suddenly we were able to actually take those different contrasts together and try to actually understand what is the bolt signal, what is it made up of, where do the signal changes happen, can we test balloon models and wind Kessel models and whatnot, and all this work, of course, ensued. And it was actually exciting to be able to measure blood volume changes in the awake human, which previously was only done in animals with, you know, contrast agents. And so that was actually a quite exciting work. Actually, quite soon after, I should say, we probably also recognized that it was a bit overrated to say we can only excite one slice at exactly that point. I mean, Renzo now samples like for 200 milliseconds around that nulling point, and it gets a very high resolution out of the vaso. But the purest thing to do would be to really sample at one point where the blood goes through zero. Okay, so when this happened, I had just started my PhD. That was in Nijmegen with David Norris, as you said earlier. So he actually came running down the corridor and said, well, Ben, this is super cool, you got to do it. Well, I didn't for a couple of years, but at the end of the day, we started playing with vaso anyway. So this is 3 Tesla stuff, mind you, this was Han Zhang's. This is not just high field here. So this was a 3 Tesla. And we had a gray sequence going for something else anyway. So we figured, okay, well, let's put an inversion pulse in front of the gray sequence. And then excite in the moment where supposedly the blood goes to zero, and ta-da, we got whole brain vaso activation maps, which we found super exciting using some visual motor stimuli. And taking this a little bit further, we even actually did, that was a Stroop task with like color word matching, sort of like a classic Stroop kind of experiment. And you could really measure this sort of cognitive activation regions with vaso. Now that was actually quite nice at the time, that we could do it like in a single shot with a reasonable TR, with a T2 contrast, so there's no dropouts and anything like that. We could even see that here, there's very little in the bolt for those thick slices, but in the vaso it kind of worked because that was gray spaced. Nevertheless, okay, let's move away then from 3 Tesla and my youthful past. But anyway, it was fun to play with, for sure. Yeah, and then this paper happened. That was Jun's, right? And that was actually some of the most sophisticated sequence work I've ever seen. I remember reading that paper, and it's actually really impressive, all the different aspects of making vaso work at 7 Tesla under all the Zaar constraints and whatnot, and the different aspects you consider with the MT preparation, what inversion pulse to use, the different equilibrium module that you put here for some T2 prepping, and then how to do the rapid 3D gradient echo readout, which you continue using in other contexts as well. Anyway, it's actually pretty impressive that this suddenly started working at 7 Tesla as well, because we had tried, I have to say, we had tried that in Essen and we couldn't get it to work because we tried the Gray's approach and we just couldn't do it with all the RF power. So that was nice. Also came along this guy, I ran into him quite precisely 10 years ago, 2 months ago, probably at the Whistler workshop. I remember that very well, doing my Hawaii postdoc. We were over there for some skateboarding, for some snowboarding. And Renzo was there, and he came, still very, you know, modest and shy, and saying, oh, so Ben, and you've done all this vaso stuff, can we talk? And I said, well, I've done some, but I don't think I have much to add to what you already know, because he has started playing with vaso at 7 Tesla in Leipzig. And they were really going for high resolution stuff right from the start. You know, he was, you know, under supervision of Bob Turner and to some degree Dimo Ivanov at the time, and they were really going to go for it. So I mean, we've known that from the animal literature, right? That CBV fMRI is very specific to the microvessels potentially, and if we can really do that with vaso in a human, even if initially limited to a single slice, let's take the limitation, whatnot, that would actually be really, really cool and give us something that Bull just wouldn't be able to give us. Maybe Spinecho, but even Spinecho has sort of some downstream components, right? So over the years, he's been working on the sequence, and he's been, I dare say now at this point, single-handedly driving the field of vaso forward in incredibly, with an incredible amount of dedication and motivation, but also in lots of success. I mean, year after year, I think vaso's getting us closer and closer to something which is hopefully going to be routinely applicable to even naive users very soon. So this is the sequence in its current form, pretty much. So you have your global inversion pulse, you wait some time, second inversion time, and then comes a readout, which could be a multiband readout as initially used, or it can be a 3D EPI readout as more commonly used now for the vaso context. So here's the multiband pulse, here's the 3D slab selective pulse. And the first inversion would give you a blood volume weighted image, so the vaso image as it were, and the second image acquired at the later time here would be the bolt weighted image, which gives you a better measure of the bolt at the same time, but it can also be used to do the bolt correction on the first image, because there will be some amount of bolt contamination in that image anyway, and you can divide it out by using the information from that second one. Yeah, so then there's some additional things you can play to optimize the sequence, but this is basically the setup of the vaso sequence. Yeah, it's been applied to a bunch of cool things. I think the first real impactful application and demonstration of it was in his neuron paper in 2018, where he used vaso to study the input and output from primary motor cortex, and using sort of smart manipulations of different combinations of, you know, finger tapping with and without touch, and touch only, or and real tapping bilaterally, you could manipulate the activation in the input and output layers, and was able to tease them apart using the vaso, the depth resolution that the vaso delivered, whereas the bolt kind of struggled with it. And you can see here the typical bump in the sort of stronger amount of bolt signal towards the peel surface, the CSF here, versus the vaso is overall flatter, but it gives you a nice and clean resolution of the different depths here. The question, of course, was at the time, can we extend this across brain regions and hemispheres? Because what Lorenzo had implemented in the vaso at the time was, it's sort of a fairly thin slab of sort of 3 or 4 centimeters of coverage, but no more than that. And a lot of his work in the recent 2 or 3 years has been on actually extending the coverage of the sequence. Yeah, so another quite cool application of the vaso that he's shown was actually not in this case resolving cortical depth, but having the high resolution along the columns. And he looked at the columnar digit representations of the hand. And if you look along the cortex, along the columnar direction here, you find in the motor cortex a representation of the different digits along the different bits of cortex here. And again, the observation was that this is actually better to observe with the vaso, whereas with the boulder gets a bit blobby, not least because the opposing banks of the sulcus here would actually start blurring into each other and get a bit harder to resolve. Yeah, so this is actually quite nice what you can do. Just to make life a bit harder, we thought, okay, well, let's try to do this at 9.4 Tesla, not the finger tapping, just to get any vaso work in there at all. And it was really hard. It was really hard to actually deal with these R constraints that we suddenly had. Also because we are more conservative, because it's a sort of custom coil and so forth, but it was just getting pretty tough. Also, B1 inhomogeneity is a bit annoying. You see the B1 map here. and we ended up toggling between different sets of RF shim for the for global inversion, and then having a shim on the region of interest where we actually did the imaging. Nevertheless, after a few nights, things actually worked out, and that's the sort of data that came out of it. So again, pretty nicely separated activation ribbons here on the vaso, whereas on the ball it gets a bit blobby. And this was quite repeatable across participants, but also across days. So that worked, but it required more work than we thought, actually. So also because there are three scanners, three different field strengths available in Maastricht, there is one or two lucky participants who have been in each scanner, and Renzo scanned them and did it vaso at all field strength. I'm not going to really go into a comparison here of what this means or what you see, but the point is really that you could in principle then actually do these kind of comparisons quite easily. Take note of this here. That's the other effort that Renzo's really been pushing for, is on the one hand increasing the coverage of vaso at 7 tesla in particular, but also making vaso work better, actually make it work well at 3 tesla, where previously was a bit limited. And he's really getting to the point where vaso is actually working quite well at 3 tesla as well. And in a way that's great, because I mean, of course we have lots and lots more 3 tesla scanners in the world than we have 7 tesla scanners, and the impact of making the like a proper layer resolve technique available at 3 tesla is of course much greater than what you can offer to the community as a whole with 7 tesla, just because of the widespread availability of their field strengths. So yeah, in terms of coverage, that's really been the big thing that he's been working on. And we've had in the lab an intern, or like an exchange student, Kenjo Koshio from Japan, who was with us, or was with Renzo, I should say. And they really spent a lot of effort on actually optimizing acquisition protocols, acquisition like details such as how to actually do the sampling order of the K-space and the different segmented 3D EPI acquisitions in such a way that the images actually come out very nicely. It's a bit an analogy to the importance, certainly if you use Grappa, on how you sample your calibration data, how well the images will ultimately reconstruct. And the same actually goes for the image acquisition per se, if you then do a Grappa type reconstruction afterwards. So it makes a huge difference if you, for instance, sample your K-space in this order, although nominally you sample the same points, or whether you have a shifted Kaipe acquisition, as in this case, the images with other things being equal will look worlds different. So this is the sort of stuff that Kenjo and Renzo spent some time on, like quite some time on, in fact. And they generated actually a very, very good data set where they could see how consistently things actually activated over days, over the same participants, but also across participants. They got a whole brain TSNR, which is actually pretty impressive. I mean, some regions better than others, of course, but on the whole, good coverage of the whole brain. And this is actually a data set that I've made openly available. As you can see here, and you can find it and play with the data there if you like. So this is all shared publicly. And this was shared at the ISMRM as well as the High Field Workshop recently in Lisbon. Yeah, so also, Renzo's been working a lot with David Feinberg on the scanner in Berkeley, where they have a very high performance head grading system, which runs at a slew rate of 1,000 roughly, and a gradient amplitude of 200, which of course allows you a lot more freedom with pushing your EPI than you can in a normal clinical system. That scanner also comes with a 96-channel receive coil, which also means that you can do a lot of parallel imaging on top of already shortening your readouts a lot simply by pushing the gradient so much harder. And this is what enabled him to get the sort of actually better than 0.4 isotropic resolution vaso maps that he showed at the ISMRM recently. Yeah, so this has been quite exciting. And all this was done remotely in the times of Corona. So there were evenings around the deadline where he just logged in to scan on the scanner in Berkeley. That was actually quite fun to see how they were able to do that. This is a lots of credit there to Renzo for that work. Okay, I want to talk about a bit more about non-vaso stuff now. So I'll talk a little about ASL. which we've done quite a lot in my group as well. It's the legacy of Kamil Uludag as well, I suppose, and Dimo Ivanov is really into ASL techniques. And first thing we took, of course, was an EPI sequence, like with ASL, and we multibanded it into like an SMS EPI sequence. But we also did multi-echo with it, multi-TI, and so forth. And after 5 or 6 years of that data lying around and having been shown in various places, it actually turned into an isomerism abstract. So here we go. Congratulations to Dimo on that, if he's watching during his holidays. I don't think so, but I'm very glad this thing has been brought to some sort of closure. Anyway, so this is actually very nice because this is what allows you to do pretty much whole brain. You're missing the cerebellum, of course, but it gets you very close to whole brain coverage if you can actually do ASL with multibands, factors of 2 or 3. That is really becoming quite game-changing. If you then, at the same time, combine it with a multi-inversion timed readout, you can actually do pretty much whole brain coverage if you like, but then if you look at the different inversion times, you can really see how the blood kind of comes in through the supplying the arteries and then spreads through the vessels and then ultimately through the cortex and then drains off again at the later inversion times. So those things are kind of nice, and I suppose it could be used also in a setting where you basically look at pathologies and see how the delays and sort of blood supply in different areas are in the brain, maybe vessel occlusions and so on, if you sort of look at the latencies in the different regions. Right, so we have a lot of tools available, but then there's this guy Kamil Uludag, and he said he wanted to do ASL at really, 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 really high resolution, not to measure activation in this case, just to measure blood flow. And he said, okay, let's do 0.7, and he wanted to know if we can parcellate the brain based on blood flow. And then we were silent and said, no, we can't. And the first thing we figured, though, I mean, given how important it was to move to a 3D readout for the bull tab acquisitions, first we 3D-ified the ASL sequence, which we did. But even that, of course, wasn't enough, right? I mean, the main challenge was going to be, how do you acquire at that resolution the brain? And it would really have to be, it had to be done in multiple slabs. It had to be done in 5 steps, and it had to be done over multiple days, and the data had to be averaged, and the sensitivity of ASL, as we know, was really low. And then data had to be averaged across sessions after the slabs were put together. But all this was done, and this is like lots of credit here to Roy Haas, who was a PhD student of Kamil at the time, for actually doing this work. And in the end, what it turned out, it is possible to parcellate the brain regions by blood flow. So if we look at the T1 maps, as it were, and we see the stripe here around the this area here, it is somewhat reflected in the CBF as well, right? I mean, that speaks somehow to the vascularization of those areas that are just higher. And this sort of matches also the areas where there's, basically the higher we see higher T1 values, also the myelation is different. So it was actually very nice. And whatever it means now at this point, I'm not going to go into that, but it is actually possible to look at the blood flow, steady state blood flow, as some way of parcellating the brain. Okay. Taking resolution a notch down to 0.9 millimeter. There was another PhD student in the group, Sri Kashyap, at the time. He's again now with Kamil, actually in Toronto, who was trying to do laminar functional CBF fMRI, right? There was lots of vaso going on, of course, but then, why not do functional CBF as well? Should be possible, right? Anyway, so that was the mission, again, using a 3D EPI readout with the regular ASL preparation. He went about to do CBF measurements with simple functional paradigms and compared that to BOLD. And so interestingly, the CBF and the BOLD maps, they weren't actually overlapping. So if you look at the not spatially overlapping the labs by itself, also the curves, they had pretty distinct laminar profiles. So here we see the blood flow in the V1 and V2 versus the same for the BOLD, which again has the bias towards the PL veins here. And this is absent in the blood flow maps altogether. this bias here. So that's fine. But I mean, it's quite intriguing how the non-spatial overlap is, and also how different the patterns of the curves really is. Yeah, so we have another tool that we can use to do laminar imaging, that is CBF. So it can be done with the amount of patients and the right sequence at hand. So finally, in this part, I want to talk about arterial blood contrast. So that's been sort of brought up. It's come out of the Nijmegen group in the last few years. 2017 is not correct. That must be 2020 or 21. Jennifer Schulz there and David Norris's group, they basically said, okay, fine, there might be some other way of generating CBV contrast, and that is by selective saturation of the tissue signal, which basically leaves the arteriola or arterial blood to be imaged for the signal changes there. And the way to achieve that, of course, the selective saturation would be by using a suitable MT preparation and followed by some fast readout. And this here is stealing slides from Nikos Provolos, who basically painted this in a very nice over animated picture here. So we have upon activation, you have the blood flow go into the arteries and through the tissues and the draining veins. And if you look at the different T2 times of arterial blood, of the venous blood and the tissue, and consider also that the tissue is made up of lipids and free water. And the exercise would then be here to apply a pulse saturation that is targeting the tissue and suppress that in such a way that we then have a magnetization transfer going on between the macromolecular pool that we are saturating and into the free water, leading to an overall suppression of the tissue. And as you do that, you would then read that out, in this case with a 3D EPI acquisition, where each segment is being prepared with one of these pre-saturation pulses, the MT saturation pulses, which leads to a relative suppression of the tissues and the relative enhancement of the relative signal of the arteries being stronger. So giving you some sort of sensitization towards the arteriolar signal changes, whereas the others are suppressed. The question, of course, is what is the spatial specificity of this? And that is what he addressed in this abstract. Here's just some images that he got, just for an impression of what they look like and what the orientation was. There's a bit just into the submillimeter range here, 0.9 isotropic. And this is like a bolt type acquisition, which basically be the same acquisition, but without the MT pulses being applied all the time, otherwise would be the same. Here's the ABC acquisition, where you have the saturation pulse between each plane. And this is the ratio image. Anyway, so the task, so those are the acquisition parameters. 0.9 millimeter, as I said. And I think importantly here is that the B1 was set to 10 microtesla and it consisted of 7 pulses being applied. So actually, I skipped over that on the previous slide, but targeting the tissue pool selectively to suppress that in particular and leave the other ones intact as much as possible. Yeah, the task was a simple touch, no touch kind of task to again manipulate the input and output layers. And all he wanted to see was, can ABC resolve those? And well, the observation was yes, pretty much. For a first shot, not too bad. And here showing 6 participants with the ABC data and the bold data. And here the ABC and the bold plotted in red, the ABC and the bold, the blue. You can sort of say that it is sort of consistent across participants here, and that it is overall flatter for the bold with this tendency to increase towards the CSF, whereas the ABC has the ability to actually pick up those bumps at the different depth levels here. Yeah, so, what's happening here? Okay, so this is also the reproducibility over days. So for the case of 2 participants here, scanned on 2 successive days or 2 different days, it was actually quite possible to repeat that. So if there is some chance that ABC contrast is actually able and suitable to do these measurements of laminar fMRI. But I think some more work is needed. It's still quite a new technique, and you're not going to have a competitor for VASA one from one day to the next, I don't think. Anyway, more work to be done on that, but it's very promising for sure, and I think we should be watching that spot. Yeah, returning to Gradon Echo Bold for just a moment. I do I can't be in this room here without mentioning the T2 prepared. Great in echo imaging, of course. Again, Jun's work here from 5, 6, 7 years ago, which I think is also quite important because it is seeing some pretty cool applications still, and just also recently been shown. It is a T2 weighted method, which basically consists of a T2 preparation module, similar to what was already sort of hidden away in the VESA sequence I showed earlier, and then followed by a fast 3D graded echo readout, which has super short echo time and doesn't have any distortion, so it's B1 insensitive, and is not really sensitive to dropouts, which is also great, but it gives you, it makes you sensitive to T2, basically, right? So like a spin echo bold type sensitivity. Not a lot of sensitivity, but you don't have to deal with all these artifacts. And that is the key here because it makes you accessible, gives you access to all these tricky areas like the olfactory bulbs, for example, that some abstract was just shown at the ISMM here. And at the Highfield workshop in Lisbon, even so the application to some sort of laminar fMRI in the end around the contact. So that is actually pretty promising stuff that, you know, bold will not get you there so easily with an EPR readout. I think you can probably forget that. Anyway, I wanted to mention it not only because you are here, Jörn, but also because I think the T2 it is one important weapon in the arsenal. I think that we have to actually study the more difficult areas of the brain for functional imaging. Yeah, so how am I doing for time here? Oh, there's a little bit of time left. I was told there is 1.5 hours to talk, so that's good. We do a lot of non-Cartesian stuff in Maastricht recently. Running after everyone who's been doing that successfully lower field strength, we're now struggling to make it work at 7 Tesla. But it is nice to do because, I mean, at least in principle, it gives superior sampling efficiency. It gives, in terms of how do you sample your case space, it also gives you superior undersampling efficiency because you can make use of the cold profiles better. But in reality, those things do not always jump out at you. Also, again, because I think EPI has just been optimized for so many years that it's hard for the spirals to catch up. And there are lots of challenges involved with the spirals, but there have been very, very successful demonstrations, especially from the group in Zurich. They've shown it for bold using sort of spiral in out or just spiral out acquisitions here in this case. Usually they do it in conjunction with field monitoring using scope and the field corrections. And here just some data from Lars Kasper's recent paper in NeuroImage, where they had some 0.8 isotropic resolution functional images acquired with spiral out. So this is very promising and very nice. We've had, as you figured, had quite some interest at CBF and VASO. And spirals are sort of obvious candidates for that also, because those two are ideally acquired at short echo time, and then why not excite? And then you do your spiral out and acquire data at the very short echo time in order to maximize the SNR, but also to keep the bold out as much as possible, because you don't want to have bold in those. You don't need it and you don't want it. And yeah, here's my PhD student, Dini Koban, who's been working on multiband spiral with, in this case, blood flow and bold imaging. So what she did was doing a spiral out to capture the blood flow and the spiral back in to capture the bold. And unless you're too overambitious with spatial resolutions, you can actually make it so that the spiral in lands at a suitable echo time to sample your bold, which is about 28 here for the bold at 7 Tesla. Seems quite reasonable. And we're getting some reasonable images out of that as well at the sort of moderate resolutions. So the short echo image and the longer echo image, the spiral out and the spiral in. And looking at the perfusion and bold activations here, it's perfusion here, spiral here, Cartesian here, so it's an EPI for reference. We weren't completely overwhelmed by how fantastic the spirals do, but at least they don't do worse than the EPI. If you look at the bold activation, a similar story here. They do about comparably well. The spiral actually doing somewhat better because the echo time is long versus the EPI being so short. However, once you really start getting into the domain where the spirals really shine, is that is some high resolution, we really saw that the spiral, or I should say the spiral doesn't shine, but the EPI fails. Maybe that's a better way of putting it, because I mean, doing ASL stuff with at high resolution with EPI gets tricky because the echo time gets pushed out so far, and that is just problematic. And this is then the images we got with the spiral here. So like good quantitative maps. But if you do the comparison of the SNR of the spiral, which is a lot higher than the EPI, which is that the fairly late echo time, just by virtue of the matrix size being so large, you really see that the EPI is starting to struggle at those resolutions. So you either have to start segmenting, which is going to be very costly in acquisition time, or spiral is really the way to go. We could even do some activation with those high spatial resolution spirals. So we get some fairly reasonable results here. And with the Cartesian, that just becomes increasingly difficult. Yeah, so that was sort of moderate sort of resolution still, of course, with Renzo on the team here, and he's taking a picture here of those three people that work on it. So this is Denis here and Alejandro and Emily, who regrettably left us. The plan is also to push this towards layer resolutions and to combine it with VASO. And of course, once you have an LZL sequence, the VASO sequence isn't that far away. So same readout, different preparation. And in this case, we use for the reconstruction what comes with the scope system. They have an image reconstruction software, which actually works quite nicely. And here, I think the normal comparison, what everybody would hope and expect, is the SNR of a spiral, because the echo time is so short, being a lot higher than that of Cartesian EPI, which comes at a late echo time in this case because of that high resolution. And now moving on from that to the activation maps with VASO here, it really shows that at those high spatial resolutions, the spirals do outperform what EPI can give you. And you can really see here the activation patterns. I mean, without actually going too much into the details here, they just come out much, much better than what you get with the Cartesian at an echo time of 20 in a VASO. I mean, things just start to fail and not go so well. Anyway, spirals may well be the way to go once the reconstruction and other challenges are better resolved than we have been able to so far. Yeah, moving from the 2D to 3D, we've actually gotten a bit desperate, waiting for scanner updates and so forth, and started implementing sequences in PulseSec, which is a MATLAB-based and vendor and platform-independent way of actually coding your sequences. So then, you know, when our upgrade comes, we can just take the sequences we have now and run them on the new scanner without having to recode anything. That is actually quite convenient. Anyway, and it's also nice for rapid prototyping. Just trying things out quickly on your laptop and then take it to the scanner, it'll run and you don't have to work in the Siemens environment and so on. So it is actually quite a nice way to do coding now. Right, so those two people are doing this, going from 2D to 3D, that's Emily Ma who left and Alejandro Manuel, who's also a PhD student in my group. And it basically is the same picture, the same VASO sequence again, but all the 3D EPI partitions have now been replaced by pancakes of spirals or a stack of spirals. And nice is that it actually works. So at this sort of fairly decent resolution for a start, we can get some fairly robust VASO activation, which looks okay in comparison to what you would expect from the bold activation in the same place. So it's some more work to be done there in terms of reconstruction quality and the B0 corrections and acceleration capability of those sequences. But it's looking actually very good that we can actually use those short echo time techniques for VASO and CPF soon. Right. Yeah, I've now talked a lot. And just to wrap up, I suppose, I come to sort of connecting all the bits and go back to the points that I made initially, is that there's a lot of things that, play into making things work in the end. And that's, of course, it's the main B0, it's the gradient performance, it's the transmit, the receive, as I mentioned, the different pulse sequences, all the choices we have, getting your image reconstruction right, and then asking the right question, your paradigm designs and how you deal with the data. But it is also very important that you pick the right fMRI contrast for your questions. I mean, you've seen there is a lot of alternatives to just doing gradient echo bold, but also so there is a lot to pick from, but I mean, you also need to make your choices wisely, I suppose. And it's not always obvious what you need to do, I suppose. EPI is a good one to start with. It's a very versatile and mature sequence, and they can be used with most of those contrasts I've mentioned. But it may well be time to move on to some other contrasts and also readouts for specific applications that, you know, we may want to deal with. And of course, there is already a plethora of MRI contrasts, some of which I've mentioned, and there is, I'm sure there'll be more to explore in the future. And I'm sure there's some little tricks we can do in MR. And this, the nice thing about MR physics is there's always a little extra trick we can play somehow and discover something new that we can then put to use in some good way. And finally, and this is, I guess I've pretty much ended every talk on this because it is just so true. Do not underestimate the power of simple solutions. And this is just so, so true, right? Don't over-engineer anything. Take the bits that are out there and use them, put them together in a smart way. And you can do quite some magic with it half the time. That is actually, that is really nice. Yeah. And with this, I'd like to thank at least those people on the slides here. There's probably some that I've forgotten and lots more that should be on there. But I'd also like to thank you, everyone here, for watching. And I think there will be opportunity for questions for those who want. Thanks.
Wow, thank you so much, Ben. This is a really amazing talk, very comprehensive. And you know, you talk about the state of the art technology, and also some previous development in the early days, and very educational. I'm really glad we have this recorded, so we can put it on our YouTube channel, and we can come back to this anytime we want. So thank you so much for putting together this great talk. So now it's question time. So I already get lots of questions coming. So please use the Q&A box, or you can, if you want, you can do the chat as well. So the first question, Ben, can you see that? Do you want me to?
I can, yeah. Can everybody see if I put it here? Does that make sense? I don't know what is shared at the moment.
It's either way you want to.
Right.
I can read that, or you can share, just put it on your screen and start to answer the questions.
Yeah, given the finding that vaso maps better to microvasculature and bulb maps better to macrovasculature, what does that say about bulb-based functional connectivity maps? Are they more likely to map the downstream vasculature and less likely to map the networks related to neural activity? Well, I guess that is a very valid question, and I haven't really been able to quantify or qualify my statements with weighting towards the downstream vasculature, right? I mean, even a weighting towards the peeled surface is something that we at high resolution refer to as weighting towards the downstream vasculature, but it does not, I think, does not compromise our ability to look at connectivity maps at the resolution that we normally do that, unless you're really interested in connectivity maps at the cortical depth resolution, right? I mean, you could want to create connectivity maps, for example, considering input versus output layers, but I don't think that is what this question here is about. I think for mapping the networks, you're not doing anything wrong by doing a simple gradient echo bolt acquisition at a reasonable acquisition resolution. But yeah, if you do gradient echo bolt, it will be weighted slightly away from the neuronal activation, but that is probably fine for most applications, unless you're interested in the cortical depth information.
Yeah, great. Thanks a lot. I see one tenant raising his hand. Is the question answered? Do you want to ask the question in the Q&A session?
Yeah, where's the Q&A? Is there more questions? Oh, that's the chat as well. No, wait a minute.
Yeah, there's the chat and there's the Q&A, and I see one person raising his hand. Can you ask the question in the chat or in the Q&A? Yeah, that's okay. Any questions, you can either use the chat or Q&A. So I guess, Ben, I feel obligated to ask this question because, you know, I see some friends from neuroscience and neuroradiology background. So I think you talk about a lot about high resolution function MRI, laminar function MRI, which is very exciting. I think personally, can you comment on the potential application of these methods in either neuroscience or in some brain diseases in that regard?
Hmm. maybe that's a discussion we should rather have over beer with you. No, I don't think. I mean, for brain diseases, I'm not sure. I think we need to validate the method a bit more first to really know what's happening. So for the vasal, yes, I see there is potential actually to do that. But the question is, I mean, do we have the right clinical questions to ask to apply it? Right. I mean, in particular, I think it would have to be questions that really rely on getting a mapping of input and output between different regions of the brain. I mean, there might be psychiatric disorders where this becomes interesting. I mean, the Hunter's donor paper, of course, is one nice example of what Renzo showed. But I think actually talking about disorders where brain communication between different regions of networks fail, for that it might actually be interesting, but then we would have to have a really good sensitivity at whole brain level, or at least at the level of covering multiple brain areas and robustly resolving those things in single subjects. And I think some more work is to be done to actually enable that. But yeah, I mean, potentially that might well have implications in the future. Sorry, just mumbling and speculating.
No, I think that's a great point. I agree with you. I think in order to do that, we have to have the confidence that we can actually detect something on an individual level rather than, you know, averaging our, you know, healthy control group, right? So we got a question. So thank you. I think this was the person who raised his hand, Ruben. Thank you for putting your question in the Q&A box. Can you see that, Ben? Or should I read
it? How many of those techniques you mentioned are regularly available at 3-7 Tesla? The gradient echo bolt is definitely available. The spin echo bolt will definitely be available. The vaso, I would say, is very available for 7 Tesla now and extremely well documented with example protocols and instructions for analyzing the data and so on. I mean, thanks to Enzo's effort that he's been putting into that. Other techniques like the ABC, I think, is fairly new, but I think if you're sitting in a Philips scanner, you can just click it together at your console. If you sit on a Siemens scanner, you can't. And I think there's also too little knowledge about the interpretability of those data yet. So I wouldn't call it regularly available. I would say T2 prep, is that something that is regularly available? I don't think so.
No, it's not, right?
It's an expert sequence.
Right. We send out, like you said, we send out the special patches.
CBV, I mean, for ASL mapping, yes, that is routinely available as web packages or exchange sequences between the different research sites. So that is routinely available, but I think then here also it requires some expert knowledge to actually use them properly, because you have all these limitations in terms of SAR you need to deal with. There's SB1 and homogeneities. I mean, oftentimes, and I haven't actually mentioned them, you have to use dielectric pads, for instance, to deal with the B1 and so on. So there is some training or some, you know, experience is at least very advisable for how to use these sequences, but they're available. So that you can get them probably from Siemens if you're on a Siemens side, or from a colleague if you're on a Philips. Can we have access to the recording? Yes, I think that will be on YouTube, which we've all heard, including my mumbling now. I think they'll all be on YouTube.
Yeah, I can answer that question. Yeah, we'll it's all recorded, and we'll put the recording on our YouTube channel, and then we'll send a link every time we have a new posting. We'll send it to the whole group. I cannot agree more. You know, I think this will be, you know, a great presentation to always, you know, every time if I want to refresh myself with some literature, I'll come back to this talk. So again, thank you, Ben, this is great.
Yeah, maybe just finally to answer the QA Rubens question too, you mentioned about the interpreter PulseSec. Are some available info about how we do the transition from PulseSec to effectively run a sequence on the scanner? Well, if you're sitting on the Siemens, you will have to get the interpreter sequence, in fact, from Siemens, you would get it from Freiburg, but you would do the normal Siemens C2P. So you would have to go through that part, but then you're done with it. Then you will never have to touch the sequence again. Once it sits on your scanner, you can feed it the MATLAB files that you generate from your PulseSec environment, and it'll happily play them for you. So that is actually fairly easy.
Yeah, great. So we got a message from John Polimani from the chat. Hey, Ben, nice talk. Hope you don't mind me sitting. It's great to have you here, John. I saw you in the list. I was so happy, you're here. And super exciting to see spiral vaso implemented. I thought when I saw the spiral images, it looks really amazing. Right? One thing I was wondering, with a spiral, you always have this extra blurring. I wonder if you look at the point spread function or some other evaluation you can do with that.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can calculate that the overall point spread of the spirals is not actually worse than that of EPI. It just it's made in the different directions.
Right.
It's well, honestly, I'm not so happy with the spiral images yet. I think we still have a lot of work to do in comparison to what they've been able to achieve on. I think certain groups, and we all know which ones I'm talking about, they have a lot of experience with spiral. It's experience that has grown for 20 years, and they just have expert knowledge and expert tools how to do the B0 correction properly. And I think it all stands and falls with that. And we are still struggling a bit, actually. So there is some blurring and some distortion or deformation, I should say, left in our spirals that we need to work on. And it's tricky, actually. It's tricky to make them look good. And
right.
we haven't quite figured it out yet. But there is a lot of knowledge in Zurich in particular on how to do this. And I think I will shamelessly say here now also that a lot of that knowledge has flown into what the reconstruction of the scope system does. So that seems to actually work really nicely. So for some of the applications and some examples that I actually showed, we actually use that. Yeah.
Right. Okay, great. So I guess we can, we can talk about this stuff, the whole day, right? If we can do it. So I think it's almost time, for this lecture. So if no other questions, thank you so much again, Ben, for this amazing talk. And it's great to see you, although I know we just see each other in London, but it's never enough time for us to chat on these stuff. So thank you again.
Thanks.
Yeah. And we look forward to more amazing work from your group, in this direction. And thank you everyone for attending this seminar. We'll see you actually in 2 weeks for the next month's seminar.
Yeah. Thanks everyone again. Yeah, thanks for inviting and thanks everyone for tuning in and listening and the questions after.
Yeah.
Okay.